2 Overdrive continues, brought to you by FanDuel, bringing you everything from the opening line to the final score. Role play level of concern later in the hour. Scott Hartnell coming up here in a moment. Leafs Kings tonight. Sounds like Timothy Liljegren will get back in the lineup, which, you know.
Who's out? Timmons?
Yeah, Timmons. And okay. Timmons has not been great through three games.
No,
and, we're talking about a third pairing defense. We're talking about a battle for the sixth defense. I think when Hakanpaa is healthy, if he gets healthy, he'll probably step in there. But, we'll see if Willie plays tonight. Willie's under the weather. It sounds like Tavares will play, but he was telling the media, I guess, he lost like 8 pounds over the weekend. He was so sick.
Jeez.
Yeah, it's been a struggle. And, I said yesterday I thought we'd see a big McDavid, Draisaitl, Bouchard night last night, and we saw a semblance of that. They won the game, and Draisaitl had an assist, and he had the OT winner, and McDavid was kind of buzzing as the game went on. It was pretty routine, early in the game.
They got points, but
they were not dominant against a young Philly team who had been playing a lot out in Western Canada. But now you turn the page to where the Leafs are at, and I'm sniffing out a Matthews masterpiece tonight. I don't know if you guys are feeling that, but he's got three straight without a point, no goals. People are attaching the captaincy thing to it, and new coach, and you're
bridges.
Trying to kill penalties. And
that Joe from the bridge.
Nobody
comment.
Else is attaching a captaincy other than
tell them
Joe
what
from
the board
bridge.
That they want are the what.
Then versus now.
Now it's labeled then versus now. Yesterday it was captain concern ? That, he had six games through three games last year or six goals through three
then
games.
Then versus
got
now. That is insane.
I mean, those are stats. And I know stats are for losers. Losers are nerds. Therefore, nerds are stats or whatever it is. But those are just factual numbers. Yet I have a feeling the big boy is going to come out chugging tonight. And Dave Riddick's in net, former teammate. I think he's going to be very familiar with Austin Matthews tonight.
It just seems like when he has those three games, it's a game like this. And I'm not saying it happens tonight, but he gets out and gets ahead of it early, and then it's over with, and then he just starts filling the net.
That's another good point. It's like 5 minutes into the game.
Yes, and then it's like, okay, what the hell's this guy going to do tonight?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's what I'm waiting for. I think most Leaf fans are bracing for that.
He's usually a first goal guy, like first shift or two, and that's how it goes. I don't know. I mean, Dave Riddick hasn't played a league game yet. He played in the preseason. I was talking to him in Ottawa the other day. But, Rocco with the glass eye or whatever, he's not playing.
So when would he have, how does that transaction go down? After the game, he tells the trainer, I don't feel like something's not right?
Might have tweaked
or does he wait till the next day?
I don't know. There's flu going around. I will say that. But I might be sick, might be hurt. I don't know. Not available. It's David Riddick, and they called up Phoenix Copley.
Yeah, Darcy Kemper's not even dressing. I'm not sure he's in the building tonight.
Yeah,
for LA.
I think it's more, LA. This kid, this Clark kid, is a really nice player. Like Brant Clark.
Yes.
You should see this kid.
Bro, junior kid.
Whew.
Yeah, no, they got some good players. I mean, Quinton Byfield's a local guy.
He's a horse. Yeah.
He's obviously played really well last year, and this is not going to be an easy game.
No, LA's a good team. That's what I was going to say.
They get up for this, too. They generally do. Like Jim Hiller was talking about it today. Why don't we play the clip?
Sure.
The head coach of the Kings. Because this is generally the Drew Doughty show when the Kings roll through town for the first time.
Yeah.
Right? Doughty's got all his family up from London. He loves doing media up here. He loves putting his stake in the ground. Don't forget about me and the Kings out in L.A. He loves this swing, and he loves Toronto in particular.
My year for the Norris.
Spread the word. I'm
Which
here
a lot
I'm
of those it. Years was true.
Yeah, he's obviously a great, great player. But broken ankle, not playing, not up here on the trip. And here's what the head coach of the Kings had to say about that earlier this morning.
Do you sense the Toronto area guys have the juice coming into a game like this?
It's always like that, yeah. Of course, we're missing Drew, who Drew loved to play in Toronto. We bring everybody in from London. But so he's saying, encouraging the guys and letting them know that you don't lose when you come into Toronto.
All right, there you go. Can't lose when you come into Toronto. But their captain, Anze Kopitar, has been lights out early in the year.
He's
been great.
Yeah, he's 37 years old.
Well, him and Malkin are like leading the league in points, are real close to it, and I find there's a lot of similarities between those two in terms of like being under the radar, and they shouldn't be. And you know, Malkin obviously was in the shadow of Sid and still is, and that's just always going to be his reality because they never left Pittsburgh. And I think in L.A., to an extent, you know, Doughty probably shines a bit more than Kopitar. I don't know if that's fair to say that, but I think, you know, from the outside of the market, it feels that way.
Bigger personality, too.
Bigger personality, absolutely.
Been a damn good player for a long time, though, man.
Yeah.
Like, where would he rank for you all time? Like, is Kopitar, you know, let's not say all time. Let's say over the last 15 years, since the cap was implemented, since 2005-06, where is Kopitar?
I think he is right up there. And if you want to just go for, like, he's a little bit less sexy than the Stamkos, Tays, like, but he's right there with those guys that were the number one centerman that brought cups to their organization.
I think when I think of Kopitar, for some reason, I think of Patrice Bergeron. Like, Bergeron was known as this two-way player, not always was a 100-point guy or anything like that, was just more, hey, this guy did everything right. Andre Kopitar gets points. Like, I believe, again, keep in mind, I did a game the other day, but there was a stat. I think he's led his team in scoring, like, for, like, years. Like, it's him every year type of thing. Now, I think Kempe might have got him last year. I'd have to double-check on that. But it's just, this guy is consistent. He plays hard. Mm-hmm. He's a great captain. He's loved. I kind of compare him a little bit to Barkov, where, like, Barkov is quiet.
Yes. He was the original Barkov, if you want to
call it that.
Exactly.
That's kind of what I like. When I think of comparables, like, that's what but people are like, geez, you got to lay eyes on this Barkov. Well, that's what Kopitar was for years in L.A. in a quieter market, right? Not as front and center.
Yep.
That's what it was
for 70 points, 80 points, two-way guy, center, shoots left. Like, there's a lot of similarities there.
Yeah, yeah.
All right, here's a longtime NHLer. You see him on the NHL Network. Here's Scott Hartnell joining us on the Maple Toyota Hotline. What's happening, Scott?
Not much. How you fellas doing?
We're doing well. We're gearing up for Leafs-Kings tonight. We're just talking about Kopitar and, you know, trying to get a read on his rank because he's off to another great start. He's won two cups, captain out there in L.A., you know, yet seems kind of, like, undervalued in a way in terms of public perception. You played against him. I mean, you would have played against him a ton in your career. Where does he rank for you in terms of guys that you played against?
Yeah, he does everything well, and probably it's just not flashy. That's probably why people don't really talk about him. Like, he kind of, I wouldn't say slugs up the ice, but he's just a very methodical skater. Obviously, thinks the game extremely, extremely high. A really good shot, but just his playmaking ability. His reads defensively. You know, penalty killer, all that kind of stuff. You guys were just listening before I came on. You're hitting it all in the head, but yeah, just. Probably not one of those dynamic guys that, you know, like a Matthews that scores almost 70 or, you know, McDavid or McKinnon with the flashy skating and stuff. He just kind of sneakily, you know, gets the job done. And that's a great quality to have in a hockey player that plays, you know, 15 or, you know, 18, 22 minutes a night and winning cups and putting the team on your back, basically.
Yeah, no kidding, man. And he's played 1,376 games, too, and he's still chugging Kopitar. And, you know, the Kings are coming off a wild game on Monday in Ottawa. They lose 8-7 in overtime. And now they roll into Toronto, and, you know, Austin Matthews has gone three straight games without a point, three straight, obviously, without a goal. And I think a lot of people in Toronto, I can tell you, Scott, are anticipating the roof to pop off tonight. Like, if he goes three straight without a goal, it's generally rare. In your experience, when you play a great player like Matthews and you know he's, you know, maybe chomping at the bit or you feel like it's just a matter of time before he breaks loose, how much attention goes towards that when you're preparing for the game, kind of in anticipation that he could break loose and you don't want it to happen against you?
Yeah, it's different from like 20 years ago, right, where you can see every single goal of every game, you know, within 20 seconds of getting on your phone, right? So you know what the guy can do and – you know, almost getting 70 last year and you know, where he can score from basically everywhere. There's no really kind of shutting him down, right? And the teams have played Toronto pretty well here, kind of, you know, limiting his chances. I think he's rung it off the post a few times and whatnot. So maybe, you know, for him, it's always, being in the season, you always want to have a great start, right? And it's like, oh, man, you know, for an average player like myself, you always want to get a couple points early, get a goal early, so you're not kind of, you know, pressing a little bit, if you will, gripping the stick a little tight. But, you know, I think he's human, you know, just like everybody else. So I think it's not in his head or whatever, where the world's not falling all over him. But, you know, he'd love to have a big night tonight for the Leafs and get his season going here, back on track here, I guess.
Scotty, when you were finishing, did you notice that guys were, like, obsessed with points? Like, even guys that have been paid long-term deals, big money, not to say that they should be comfortable, but it's almost like their focus should be just kind of team wins and having success. But we're like, were guys obsessed with the stats and points?
Yeah, to a certain extent. In Columbus, you know, 2 years that Torts was there, he took those the stat packs that you always got before the game. You know, took them away so guys wouldn't look at, you know, what their stats are compared to, you know, the guys in the team. And, you know, obviously you do that on your phone in a second as well. But, you know, I always like checking, like, kind of who's hot on their team, who's not. There's a little, like, cliff notes of how you do against that team. And, you know, I'd always kind of use that as, you know, kind of getting guys loose before the game. And, you know, we'd be, say, back with the Flyers and Jake Voracek and Claude Giroux, and we're going into New York Rangers, and like, oh, you're averaging a point a game here against the Rangers. That's money on the board, and, you know, get a couple laughs out of the guys and staying loose, and you know, sure enough, they'd put a few $100 on the board, and we'd get a win and more money to the team fund. So it was kind of things like that. I used to look at it, you know, stats wise, but. Yeah, it's, you know, the more points you get, the more money you're going to get in your pocketbook, right? You know, for points wise. But, you know, towards the end of my career too, not that I was a selfish points guy, but I didn't really care what happened. I just wanted to win. My last year in Columbus, my last year playing in Nashville, was like, who gives a crap what's going on? I just want to, you know, get the win and you know, keep on moving on. So.
Scotty, bigger surprise for you, the Calgary Flames leading the league at 4-0, or the Colorado Avalanche, Nashville Predators, both 0-3. Now, until last night, Edmonton was 0-3, but they got a win. But either those teams at the bottom or Calgary at the top?
I would say Colorado and Nashville not getting a win yet, to be honest. I know UC Saros was hurt like the first game of the season, but, you know, he's been in for a couple. You know, the signings that they had, you know, I think everyone thought maybe, you know, life would be easy in the NHL this year, where every team can beat any team on every given night. But, you know, they haven't found their consistency yet. And Colorado, too, as well. Like, they got some guys that can snipe and play defense and all that kind of stuff. So, and then there's a team on the flip side that's probably close to be bottom feeders, just like, you know, like Philadelphia was last year. Everyone picked them to be second or third last, and they come out of the gates hot and surprise teams, right? So that all even out, I think, after, you know, 10, 15 games where everyone, okay, this team actually is pretty good. They play hard. They're heavy, you know, like the Flames have been. They've been running when they played Philly, you know, a few days ago, and just absolutely ran them out of the building there at Saddledome. So, yeah, you can't take anyone for lightly nowadays.
No kidding. With Scott Hartnell of the NHL Network, longtime NHLer, and, you know, we always, you know, talk about the happy meter coaches, you know, early in the season, really at any point in the season. And you mentioned John Tortorella and your time with him, and I'm curious, you know, how deep into a season, we referenced what's going on in Nashville, Colorado, Edmonton. How deep you had to get into the season before you realized your coach and his mood was changing and he was pissed off and you were facing a bad skate? Like, how long would it generally take for that to happen?
Yeah, well, it's it felt like with Torres, the more you'd win, the grumpier he would be, if you can believe that. I think we were on a 16-game heater in Columbus, like going for, I think, an NHL record. And he was more miserable coming to the rink, you know, yelling at guys, and we're just out there, you know, having the best time of our lives, winning these hockey games, and life is good. And you know, and then it's kind of the opposite, right? You lose four or five in a row, and everyone's a little bit more chippier, trying to get you in a good mood to feel those good vibes again, right? But yeah, I think, you know, in Columbus, we lost the first eight games. That's when Torts came in with Todd Richards, and, you know, it was, you know, panic city, right? You have all these extra meetings. You have, you're trying to figure out, you're trying to boost guys' confidence up, things like that. But, you know, these teams that have, you know, had a bad start, I guess you could say, if it's three games in a row, you know, they're going to get back on the schneid and get rolling again, I believe, 100%.
Yeah, I mean, that's certainly the plan. It's got to be the hope for sure. I mean, it is early in the season to, you know, be looking at all the negativity, so to speak. But, you know, in terms of young players in the league, we were talking about Torts and his current team in Philly, that Michkov kid. Man, he looks pretty good. And, you know, it was uncertain when he was going to come over, when he came over, what he would look like. You know, when you consider, you know, young players, and there's a couple of young players on Philly, really young players on Philly, you know, the importance of a veteran to make sure that they're in the right frame of mind. Like, how much emphasis did you put on yourself as you got older and into your career when you'd have young rookies come through?
Yeah, I loved it, right? Because I was one of those guys when I was 18 years old coming in, taking a veteran spot, and you definitely don't never in a million years think about, oh, I just kind of, you know, put this guy in the minors, or, you know, he's a healthy scratch, and, you know, I'm just, you know, loving every single minute, you know, going to the rink in the NHL and the charters and the food and the petty checks and all that stuff, right? And I never really thought about it when I was, you know, 18 to 24, and then, you know, then you're kind of a veteran guy, you're a leader, people look up to you, and then you're sort of like, oh, I got to make this guy feel comfortable, and then, you know, and then mid-30s, you're like, man, this guy's taking my spot. He's taking my ice time. He's taking my PP time. So it always does come full circle for a lot of NHLers that, you know, have a good career. But, you know, they're all good kids. They're all, you know, I want to say hockey nerds. You know, they just look at the stats. They're looking at, you know, just, I don't know, on their you know, iPhones or whatever. We used to hardly even have an iPhone or any kind of phone when I first came in the league. So you actually talked to people on the road. You went out for dinners. You saw the town where you were going to on the road, some sneaky restaurants, you know, a cool bar, things like that. But it's a little bit, so the game's changed a lot in that respect anyway, where, you know, guys are so dialed in and focused, and which is not a bad thing as well either.
Not too bad. I mean, the sneaky restaurants and bars, I like that on the road. There was nothing wrong with that.
Hartsy, what's your favorite? What's your favorite little sneaky bar the night before a game to just have a couple casuals?
Well, I could probably list you a bunch in every single city, but the one kind of random restaurant that I always love going to is, I think it's Cafe Roma or Roma Cafe in Detroit. Just in the middle of, like, basically nowhere, like kind of some abandoned buildings, and you go in there, it's like you're back in the 60s with the, you know, the red plaid table, like plastic tablecloths, and you try and order off the menu, and they say, no, you're gonna get this. They're telling you what you're gonna eat, right? And the little Caesar salads to start, and the crafts wine and stuff like that. So Billy Holder, he was the one guy that introduced me to that when I was an 18, 19 year old. So that was those kind of cool little places that you're like, no one's ever even heard of this place, but you know, I absolutely love going there. Every time I was in Detroit, we'd always you know, take a cab and get there for a nice long dinner. So that's kind of the stuff you miss, you know.
Yeah,
always had the watering holes. Scotty is a guy that played in that 10-foot radius and pretty much were on top of goaltenders your whole career, getting to the front of the net. What do you make of the goaltender interference so far here early in the season, and some of the goals being called back? And, you know, to me, we had a debate in the last hour. It's been tough to kind of define, you know, what you're seeing, whether it's a goal or not.
Well, I wouldn't say it's 50-50. They're always going to protect the goaltenders, right, and how delicate that position is. And, you know, it's not like when you had 1 foot in the crease and they would call it no goal, like it was, you know, late 90s, I think that was. But it's, you know, you got to protect them. You got to stay out of there, but you got to get it in the goalie space as well, too, right? So there's a fine line of, you know, what's too close or what's, you know, going to be considered legal or not. But, you know, I love the guys that, you know, go to the net, make it hard on the goaltenders, take a cross check to, you know, get one off your ass and in off your shin pad, whatever it is. It's not easy to play in front of that net, but, you know, I really, really appreciate the guys that, are tough enough to do that right now.
Yeah, I mean, look at Hyman last night. He took a Bouchard clapper off the knee, I think it
right,
was.
No, that was in the groin.
Oh,
that
yeah,
hit him
I didn't know
the
where it hit him.
Yeah, that hurt.
That one hurt.
That hit him on the cup, I think, and that's why he immediately was like, check, please.
Copping
he
in right. the net?
No, not
it
in
just
the
was. It was Bouchard takes a one-timer, probably 95 miles an hour, and he pivoted. That looked like that was straight groin. And I think Ray, I saw Ray's call on it. He's like, yeah, that was not good. And he dropped one glove and skated right into the
yeah, right in
down
the, back,
the tunnel.
Man. He was doing jumping
like
jacks.
Mark Stone's goal in Vegas, I think one of the first couple games too. It's Jack Eichel's taking a one timer and he's got
his hand.
You know, the balls to skate across the goaltender and hits him in the forearm and goes in. You know, it's he's a greasy hockey player. Mark Stone is right going not fast, not pretty, not anything. But man, he just puts up big numbers. He scores big goals, makes unreal passes, and one of those guys that. You know, you built a franchise around, really. Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. Yeah. Always great catching up with you, Scott. We appreciate you doing this. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, fellas.
Scott Hartnell joining us here on the Maple Toyota Hotline. Check out Maple Toyota's huge truck and SUV lineup, including Tundra, 4Runner, Highlander, and Grand Highlander in stock and ready to deliver. Visit MapleToyota.com.
Have you ever seen Mark Stone's grip on his stick? Like the end of, like, you know.
What's he got?
It is like three rolls of tape. Like
it's
it
the
is,
most outrageous thing
it is
you've
insane.
Ever seen in your life.
It is insane. It must weigh 2 pounds. Like somebody, I don't know if Joe from the Bridge could ever find a picture of it or whatever. It is, I can't even describe it, Brian. It is like, to get your hand around it, like it's...
You look at it, the first thing like you say is, how does this guy score? Like, how does he make skill plays with that?
It's right, how do you stick handle with that?
Yes.
Kind of
yeah. It is outrageous. But he is... I agree. Like, Hartnell loves Mark Stone because he played a lot like him. They're both, it's just a, you know,
curly
unmade,
hair, long
just
hair. They
gritty
look the
to the front of the net. And, like, Stone has an unbelievable stick as far as redirecting and getting to the front of the net. But, man, like, it's ugly. Like, the end of his stick, he's got this grip on it. It's just, it's weird looking. I'm telling you. Like, you see
I
it up
find
close.
It,
it
I've
is
never,
ridiculous.
I've never noticed it in the past, obviously.
It
he's holding
crazy.
It every time you see him.
Yeah.
But
it is crazy.
Yeah. Oh, what is that? That is
that
absurd.
Is...
That's illegal.
It is. I'm telling you, like it's got a weigh a
pound. Looks like toilet paper.
It is so. I don't even know how he gets his hand around it. Like it's like a corn dog at the
That's
end of his stick.
That's crazy,
like, it's
man.
It's the weirdest.
You gotta see like, if you're listening. You gotta find Mark Stone's. Like the butt end of his stick. That's absurd.
Yeah. I wasn't going to say the word knob, but it's like
right,
the end
watch
of
yourself.
The end of the stick. Yes,
well,
that's
remember, like Tyler Bertuzzi goes no tape.
Yes,
which
nothing.
Is equally exactly. as ridiculous.
That's as ridiculous as what you just saw there.
Yes.
No tape on a slippery one-piece stick.
Yeah, crazy, crazy behavior.
I know.
All right, role play level of concern coming up. Jimmy Ralph will join us from the rink. Leafs Kings tonight. We'll get to our best bets. Darren Dreger still to come as well. Overdrive continues. TSN 1050 and on TSN 4.
You can never, never ask me to stop drinking. Do you understand?
I do. I really do.
All right, role play level of concern brought to you by Boston Pizza, Canada's favorite sports bar. From tip-offs to tie bites and puck drops to pizza, BP's elite lineup of apps, wings, and ice cold beers always dialed in for game time. Hustle into your local BP tonight. All right, role play level of concern. I love it. We haven't done this in quite some time.
Yeah.
Lots of different roles to be played here.
Little Stevie Caldwell action.
Yeah, Stevie was looking great.
Right.
Him and Kevin Kilbenn last night down at BMO. Big win by Canada and a friendly
the
over
best.
Panama. Love
you
it.
You think Stevie went over to his little place? What is it, the Caledonian?
Yes.
I'm sure he did.
100%
sure.
he did.
A couple of whiskeys and 5 or 6 beers.
Down on Ossington, I think it might be. Or so. It's not far from BMO Field. I'll bet you Stevie popped in. Probably brought Kevin with him.
Yeah.
Right? Now
sure.
you're talking.
I think those two like hanging out with each other, if you know what I mean.
As they should. Two absolute beauticians, Stephen Caldwell and Kevin Kilbenn. And, yeah, big Canada friendly last night. Big win down at BMO. Pretty good crowd. Not the warmest night in the world, but good crowd, supportive. Big 2-1 win. I love seeing that. All right, oh, you're playing the role of Rick Tocchet. Rick Tocchet, you're a wreck to start here.
Loving it.
What is your level of concern? The Canucks, your Canucks, are regressing here and could be fighting for a playoff spot in the end.
Stevie Caldwell, please.
A couple of whiskeys and five or six beers.
It's that because of not what I've seen in the last three games or four games, however many they played. Not really about Pettersson. It's about the guy that we can't diagnose his knee because nobody knows what the hell's wrong with it, and I don't know when he's coming back.
Demko, you're talking about.
I'm talking about Thatcher Demko. Can this guy come like riding in on a horse to let everybody know that everything's going to be okay? Because you don't think that it's like when you have goaltending like that. Not that they've been awful, but you're just like, if we just get our guy back, we start winning games. That's what you're thinking.
Mm-hmm.
And nobody, that's the dark cloud that would be making me go Stevie Caldwell.
I think that's appropriate. Stevie is appropriate to me.
Yeah.
Maybe
and
with
it's like,
Kevin with him.
I think Kevin would add on probably 2 to 3 per item. Mm-hmm. Couple of beers and his 5 or 6 whiskeys. Like they would.
Yeah, but now you're heading into that Rick Bushwood territory or more.
Possibly.
You know what I mean?
We don't want
to. How about we call it
two.
Stevie Caldwell Plus?
Yes.
That means Kilbane's with him.
Right. Table for two under Caldwell, Steven.
Yes.
Yeah, he probably load up booze when he calls in and says Stevie Caldwell for two. Because they know Kilbane's the other guy.
Because Kilbane's coming with them.
He's bringing that Irish bastard with
I
him. Watch
it.
Out, man.
Yeah, a Scotsman and an Irishman are coming down after a big Canadian win. You can't beat that. You cannot beat that. It's outstanding.
Man,
all right,
man.
Yeah, you're Stevie. I think that's appropriate, personally.
I mean.
I don't know, Noodles.
Getting Dakota Joshua back, too.
Yeah,
will
that's
help
a big
because
one.
Their left side, you know, they've got Baines in their left, their top left wing last night that started with Miller and Besser, and then Heinen with Pettersson and DeBrusk. Like DeBrusk, I want to give them a little bit longer to settle in. Like DeBrusk, you change organizations, different systems, all of that. Like I think they're still a really good team, regardless who's in net, but you want to hit the ground running. It's tough to, you know, travel all the way across country.
That's a tough trip to start, too,
it
man.
It is a tough trip,
couldn't
man.
Be further from Vancouver.
Dude, it's just like, why couldn't you throw me a bone and start me in Chicago and at least go Chicago-Tampa?
Right.
Yeah. Or Chicago, Van to Tampa's the longest flight. That's the longest flight in the Nash.
Yeah,
well,
that's right.
Van to Florida, which is just across the other side of Tampa, you know, on the other side of Florida.
Mm-hmm.
But it's the longest flight. Like, that's the same thing. Edmonton, Florida was like the most travel, I believe, in a Stanley Cup final ever, mm-hmm. right? They're so far away from each other. And three time zones, all of that stuff. But you know what? I agree with you. Oh, the Stevie Caldwell is fair.
I think that's appropriate.
But it's still early.
It's early. It is early. And it's early for this one, too, Noodles. But you're going to have to handle this.
Okay.
You're playing the role of Joseph Woll. Joseph Woll, what is your level of concern? Your grasp on the number one goalie label in Toronto could be slipping away.
Give me Rick Bushwood, but I'm going to...
Okay.
6 Bush Light, 6 Bud Light, and I love them, tall boys.
Here's what.
I love that guy. That guy's still one of my favorite people
it
in
is.
Southern Ontario.
Do the math.
Here's why. Because it was... He had an opportunity. It wasn't his. It's not like they, you know, he had been here for 3 years and it was his and somebody's coming in and stealing it. What he did have is the upper hand, the inside track, because he'd been here before. They committed to him with a 3-year deal. But he has to earn it. He hasn't earned it yet. Last year, he had a season where he played some games and then got injured in game 7. And then this season, you're injured. So ultimately, the number one grasp, that's what I'm going to challenge because I don't think he had it to start off with, but I would be concerned because this is wide open. If Anthony Stolarz goes and plays great tonight, guess what he's doing? Probably playing next game. You know what I mean?
Yeah, like exactly, as he should.
So it's I think it's a wide open net. It's not his to lose, but it's his to go and get, and he hasn't been able to do that yet because he hasn't been available.
Yeah, I think that's reasonable. And like you said, I mean, it wasn't as if this guy was Shesterkin or Vasilevskiy or anything like that.
Played 36 games in the league. Yeah, that's it.
But I think that's what makes it more concerning is, like, you have the opportunity. You play well in Montreal and you're healthy, you're playing tonight. Like, that's the way it would have gone. You would have played Montreal, Pittsburgh tonight. And it's like, you're the guy. You know, Stolarz will play the next time we play. Yeah. But you're playing. And now he's out, and Stolarz has never been really granted an opportunity like this. And it's only a couple of starts, but he has been salivating, clearly, at the opportunity. And he's taken advantage of it. He's looked really good.
I would have gone Stevie Caldwell making a rezzo. Kilbenn may or may not show up.
Okay.
Oh,
it's a game-time decision on Kevin also showing up. All right, I'm playing the role of Nathan Rourke. Nathan Rourke. What is my level of concern? I've lost my chance to start for the Lions this season, and now next year could be in question.
Ooh.
Listen, I'm running sprints after practice solo. That's concerning.
Dude, I don't care what's your level of concern. We don't care about your hero sprints.
I'm just letting people know. I want to make sure everyone knows I did that, right?
Let me ask you before you give your level of concern, Nathan.
Mm-hmm.
Do you believe next year you play for BC?
Yes, I do. That's why I'm not a pine on the patio, but I'm like a. Now we've run out of options. Like Caldwell and Wade Boggs, it's too much. I'm a six pack.
Nah, you're Wade Boggs at a Lightning game.
All right, fine. Wade Boggs at a Lightning game, but he's taking it easy. All right, so he's only having like a 2-4 of light beer. All right, 18, so for Wade 18, Boggs, 18. It's just a very relaxing evening, because I'm playing next year for the Lions. They paid me a fortune. I'm going to be basically the highest paid guy in the league. They're fully committed to it. I'm a Canadian. I was the man in the past. I was the MVP. I haven't played well. I, Nathan Rourke, have been terrible, quite frankly. And I understand why they're making this move, because now the season is on the line. And Verdun Adams, prior to me showing up, was playing well. Was maybe up for the MLP, and the BC Lions, we were looking good. We were looking like we might host playoff games and maybe get all the way to the Grey Cup in our backyard. So I understand that ship may have sailed this year. Next year, no chance. I will figure this out. I will still return to where I was and to the form I've had. And I'm still a believer in what I'm capable of doing. And this ownership, this team, and furthermore, this league is dying for me, Nathan Rourke, to be playing. And that's going to happen.
Yeah, but that's the thing there, Nate boy. Sometimes you just lose it as an athlete. Are you not afraid of that? Like, it didn't work out in the NFL. We get that. And now you've come back and you just haven't had it.
Mm-hmm.
So as much as you think you're playing in BC next year, what if you continue to not have it? You're not playing there, especially when they have a backup plan.
Well, listen.
He's only 26.
I'm a young guy.
Like,
it's young, ugly. Like, not denying it. I'm also a big fan of the show. I was listening in the last hour when you were talking about when you only had 16 snipes that one year and you went 11 games and you were doubting yourself. Right?
Yeah.
As a pro athlete, I doubt myself too, but I think that's going to inspire me.
Here's the thing. When O had that slow start, O, were you out like doing extra? Were you skating, taking shots in front of the camera and all of that like Kyle Lowry did the one
Absolutely
time?
Absolutely not. I did what I needed to do.
You had a tea time probably right after practice.
Tea time.
And I wasn't. Everyone else was like, oh, I can't go golfing. I'm playing like crap. I would be like, what does golf have to do with anything? What are you
Right. It really, there's no connection to it.
Nothing.
What else you can do? Go home and stare at your screen? Or
oh, I would have the nicest polo shirt on, Tommy Bahama shorts, and I'd be on the first tee just butter fading it. Didn't care one bit.
I love it. I'm going low today. I haven't scored in 3 weeks, but I'm shooting 68.
Yeah.
You can bank on that. All right, moving on here. Oh, you're playing the role of one of your favorites, Woody Johnson, the owner of the New York Jets. Look at you, Woody O'Neill.
But do I have to play this as knowing that I'm a moron?
Yes, you have to play the part of a moron here, Woody Johnson.
Okay.
What is your level of concern? Your investment in Aaron Rodgers will not see any positive return.
Ooh. Play it.
You can never... Never ask me to stop drinking.
Nick Cage in Vegas, man. Mm-hmm. Like, I just think that there's a reason that as good as this guy was in Green Bay, like all-world quarterback, world-class,
yeah,
championship winner, all-time all of it. Great. But there's a reason they were dying for him to leave the building. And I just think that when you bring him onto the scene, he can still play at his age, even with the injury last year. There's just so much that comes with it. And now I've handed him the keys, and I'm ultimately going to pay the price, and it's still not going to be good enough, and I'm going to suffer.
Yeah.
It's Nick Cage.
I think that's reasonable, man.
It is reasonable.
You're 2-4 with this guy.
Yeah.
You've been calling it.
For years they were saying all they need with their defense is an elite quarterback, and it wasn't just we're going to go to a playoff team. It was insert Aaron Rodgers and we win a Super Bowl.
Right.
It was insane expectations.
Crazy.
Yeah.
FanDuel, like in others, had their odds as like crazy short to win the Super Bowl, to win the division, to come out of the conference.
Not
the
even
win total was
right
through
now.
The roof. No,
I don't think – I said watching those two teams play the other day, Buffalo and the Jets, I don't think either of them are really serious teams. I
but
think
the
Baltimore...
Bills are more serious than your team, Woody Johnson. I guarantee
yeah,
it.
Woody.
That I feel very good about.
Like I'm aware of it, pal. I'm
even
aware
the
of
Adams
it.
Acquisition, he's still a stud, but he's 31. Paying a premium for a 31-year-old wide receiver with huge guaranteed money left is so desperate. Like, it's so desperate.
But they are desperate.
They are, exactly.
They've got a 41-year-old quarterback that the body language on him is actually disgusting.
It's a classic pot committed move. They're just pot committed, and they're like, I got to throw all the chips in.
But rarely does it work, man. Rarely does it work. It usually burns you. All right, Noodles, you're playing the role of Morgan Riley. You are Maple Leaf defenseman Morgan Riley. What is your level of concern? Your spot on power play one is in serious jeopardy here in Toronto.
Here's why I would
you gotta
say
you got to state your level first.
Yeah, okay.
Just like the quiz.
No, I know, but I'm trying to find the appropriate amount of level here because I'm not
table
Stevie
for two
Caldwell.
Table no, for two Caldwell.
What's below that? Like I
table for one Caldwell.
No, I'm talking like
Kill Ben's coming.
It's not a glass of water. It's a pint on the patio,
wow.
But maybe a couple extra, drinks in there. Like
okay.
OEL's had a nice start, but he scored 20 goals, I believe, multiple times in Arizona. He's got a big shot, and I think that power play is missing a triggerman from the back end. But keep in mind that power play has been successful with Morgan there for a long time. Because of the other players playing better, if that makes sense. Like
right.
Austin Matthews scoring more, Mitch Marner creating, getting Willie the puck or John. So if the power play gets going with the guys who are on it, Morgan's been a part of that. I just think with it struggling, they've put OEL on there for a shot threat, which I don't mind. I actually like it because you do need a shot threat. So maybe I should be more than that, but I still think that Morgan will get an opportunity to do that. Because he has done that for years when they have had success.
I think that's a reasonable take as opposed to being, a prisoner in the moment. Because when you look at Ekman Larson, he did have back-to-back 20-goal seasons early in his career, like 14,
right.
15, 15, 16.
Yeah.
And, like, last year he had 9, the year before he had 2, the year before 5, year before 3. Like, he hasn't been loading up on offense, for quite some time. His shot is still there. I'm pretty sure he was the one that scored that goal on Jonathan Bernier.
Yeah, he was from the point D to D and in.
Yeah.
Well,
third
like,
period, start of the third period when
yeah,
Ray, was
Ray,
like, everything's
Ray was
going
like,
great.
Yeah, Jonathan Bernier's been brilliant until now.
Until
and that,
now,
that
bing.
Yeah, short hop, it went in. Yeah, it was him. I remember that night. But you know what? I think they're just looking for something else. And instead of changing out the regulars up front, it's easy to go, Morgan, we just want somebody who shoots there. Now, he does a good job of distributing the puck. I think Oliver Ekman-Larson is a good player, and he does
played
have
well.
offensive instincts. But I'm looking at the bigger picture. I think, there has been success with Morgan driving it.
Mm-hmm.
It's just a different look. Now, if OEL scores tonight or they have success, then he'll get an extended look on there.
Okay.
And that might change the dynamic. But I'm still kind of pining the patio. Maybe
they always revert back to Mo. It just seems like they just take a break and then they go back to him. I will say one thing about OEL. Playing with a bunch of different guys on the power play, he distributes the puck nicely. Like his hands, the way they hold the stick, and he dishes it out. He knows, and it's a lot about timing, like just when to pass it. If it's a hard pass, when pass to a guy that's covered, get it there quickly. He understands those concepts. I just like the way he distributes the puck.
Yeah, he's very comfortable in that situation, right? You can tell he's been on the power play his whole career. All right, we'll come back with a few more role play level of concerns that include Jerry Jones, the Colorado Avalanche, and the Montreal Canadiens. All right, a few more rapid-fire role plays. We'll get to that next. All right, role play level of concern continuing here, and I am playing the role of Cowboys owner Jerry Jones. Jerry Jones, I never thought I'd see the day where I play Jerry, and maybe I'm going to try to get you two fired. If you challenge me, I'll get you fired.
Shorts, they're destroyed. They're soiled.
Yeah, it's not a good scene. And I'm playing the role again of Jerry, and my level of concern applies to Dak's contract never paying off. Dak Prescott. I'm high on this. I'm very high. I'm not going to play it necessarily.
Really?
I will Rick Bushwood this one. It's very high.
Six
very
Bush high. Light, six Bud Light, and I love them, tall boys.
Because I just made him the highest paid player ever. Give him more guaranteed money than Deshaun Watson. It's a long-term play, though. It's not only about the first 6 weeks of when the contract kicks in. It's not good for the Cowboys. We struggled mightily. Our defense is a joke. Maybe I needed to invest more money in that. And that's where Rick Bushwood comes in. Dak, I don't know if he's got it come playoff time. I have to admit, it's Jerry Jones.
Well, that's my point. That's my point to you, Jerry. It's not about what's happened here the first 4 or 5 weeks of the NFL season. It's every year in the past, and you still had to dish out that money.
Yeah.
Why couldn't you just let this year play out?
That would have been wise.
Because he said he wanted to get the deal done, so you handed him all the bread? Are you insane?
31
yeah, you
years
are.
Do you want me to get you fired? I'm not on here to listen to YouTube buffoons.
Jerry, I have a job to do. I have a job to do. And my job is to ask questions. You don't control that.
Don't. Listen, I didn't come on here for you two clowns to tell me what I did wrong.
I'll bring in two other guys.
Other guys if I have to. Yeah. I'll do that. I'm happy to get two other guys.
But what does that even mean? Does he own the radio station?
I don't think so. I mean, as far like that just sounded like such a delusional comment, you know, from a guy who clearly is uber powerful within the market.
It sounded like a really rich guy that was shattered, and he was acting like just I'm taking my toy and I'm going home.
Right.
Like I'll buy it.
I'll just buy this
station
place
and fire you guys.
Exactly.
That's
I'll buy it, and you guys will be gone if I want to. I have to make one phone call and you're gone. Listen, Dak, it's not been good for Dak. It hasn't been good for anyone associated with the Cowboys, but he's still relatively young. Generally, he's a very good regular season quarterback. I'm Rick Bushwood. I'm concerned about the contract, but that is generally what you have to pay for the next guy up. Go talk to the guys in Jacksonville. You think they're ecstatic about paying Trevor Lawrence? Joe Burrow's making a fortune. Joe Burrow hasn't done anything.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not alone in these poor decisions right
He's
now.
He's been to a Super Bowl.
He has been to a Super Bowl. That
but
one hurts.
Burrow isn't Burrow like 25 years old?
No, he'd be a little older than that, I think. But, yeah, he's younger than Dak. Listen, I'm not saying I wouldn't take Burrow over Dak. I would as Jerry Jones, but that wasn't available to me. And who else am I supposed to play? Trey Lance? That's not going to happen. All right. Oh, you're playing the Colorado Avalanche. What is your level of concern that you could be in danger of missing the playoffs this year?
The playoffs? Are you insane? I am a pint on the patio. Obviously, Georgie 5 needs to put his gear on when he skates out on the ice because that is a major concern. But we throw out on the ice the heart winner from last year. Cale McCarr can play half the game. And as soon as we fill in the pieces, we're going to be rocking and we're going to be fine.
Yeah, they're
That roster's thin, man. You get past the top 4 or 5 guys.
Wow. I mean,
Jonathan Drouin's on your top line. I know he was there last year, but
he's
he didn't do it again.
Right, he's a, you know what? They're a good team, but they, you know, I keep telling you,
Ivan
Landeskog back.
Landeskog's not coming back. And Nichushkin, that's another one. When's he going to come back?
Well, apparently he's available in November. Like that's, and he's a horse, but yes, he's got
problems. Do you trust him? I don't know. I mean, come on.
No, he jammed the team up 2 years in a row.
Yes.
In the playoffs.
Right.
But, no, that Miles Wood is a good player. Middlestad.
Miles Wood,
Logan
for sure.
Logan O'Connor. Like, they'll be fine. They'll be
okay.
fine. Like,
there's no denying right now they stink. Like,
terrible.
They're getting
clobbered. They've allowed 20 goals in three games. 20 goals.
They'll be okay. They'll be okay. Last one, quickly, Noodles. You're playing the Montreal Canadiens. What's your level of concern? You should have drafted Matvei Michkov a couple of years ago when he was on the board.
Over?
Took Reinbacher instead.
I mean, Reinbacher seems like he's going to be a nice player. This Michkov, too, looks like a
They need
a
offense
stud.
In Montreal, man. They need it. Now, they have Demidov. They took him the next year. He looks like a stud himself.
Yeah,
but
I was watching highlights of him the other day. But, yeah, listen, I want to wait until until they both have played out.
Here. Okay.
Because I think that Reinbacher, I'm going to be six Bud Light, whatever
right.
it is. Six.
Just a couple. Just having
just
an
a couple
easy night.
Yeah, Stevie
it's
Caldwell.
Tough.
That's what I'm. Stevie Caldwell. That's
you're
what
Stevie.
I
okay,
yeah.
you're Stevie. It's tough.
A couple whiskeys and five or six beers.
Michkov's in the league. Reinbacher's recovering from surgery and not playing. You know,
exactly.
and they're so young. But that Habs fans were bent out of shape when they didn't take him 2 years ago. Because the concern was, will he leave the K? When's he coming over? Now he's here, and he looks really good.
He looks like a player, boy.
He looked good last night when I saw him. That was the first time I'd really seen him play. He looked really good. Role play level of concern brought to you by Boston Pizza, Canada's favorite sports bar, from tip-offs to tie bites and puck drops to pizza. BP's elite lineup of apps, wings, and ice-cold beers always dialed in for game time. Hustle into your local BP tonight. Jimmy Ralph from the ring. Darren Dreger coming up. Best bets coming up. Al's brother with another clue. Overdrive continues. TSN 1050 and on the TSN app.